Welcome to the first review of space and astronomy news, selected for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel. The news, which will be weekly, will try to provide a quick overview of everything interesting that has happened in recent days in the field of astronomical research and space exploration. Don't forget to keep following us. You already know this one. After a journey of almost 7 months, on February 18th, Perseverance finally landed on the sands of Jazero crater. Everything went perfectly well. Now, the rover will need a few days to activate the navigation and communication systems with which it is equipped and to start in practice its exploratory mission. That there is a lot of work to do is demonstrated by the first photo that was sent to Earth after landing. Although the rover is equipped with at least 23 cameras, including some such as the Mastcam-Z, even at very high resolution and with the ability to shoot 3D video, the first shot was rather disappointing, in black and white and also a bit blurry. Someone here has already started to turn up his nose, but don't worry. The reason for this poorly defined image is related to the fact that, at that moment, we preferred to send a low-resolution photo taken with one of the navigation cameras designed with the purpose of signaling possible obstacles. In this way, we tried not to risk overloading the transmission systems. Nothing to do with the spectacular images that we expect from Perseverance in the coming months, but the value of that first shot was more than anything else in demonstrating the success of the most delicate phase of the mission, or the overcoming of those fateful 7 minutes necessary to cross the Martian atmosphere like a bullet and then slow down to touch gently on the ground. The first panoramic photos will probably be attempted during Sol 4, the Martian day that corresponds to our February 22nd. The next day should instead conclude the control phases of the various instruments, and only then should begin the loading of the new software. At this point, new tests will be necessary to verify that the installation has gone well according to plan. Once the checks are completed, the tests to verify the rover's ability to move will begin. First, it will be the turn of the robotic arm, and then NASA technicians will begin to test the mobility of the rover. These tests will be completed within 1 or at most 2 weeks. Good work, Perseverance. Meanwhile, another piece of good news seems to have come from planet Earth. The administration of the new President of the United States of America, Joe Biden, has reiterated its support for NASA's Artemis program, which aims to bring the first human astronauts back to the surface of the moon by 2024. Certainly an ambitious date. Jen Psaki, current White House spokesperson, has in fact stated during a conference that the government will work with industry leaders to send another man and woman to the moon. Psaki herself stressed that the moon will be a sort of checkpoint for Mars. There were fears that Biden would cut funding to the Artemis mission, but this official statement brings back some confidence. Let them be quick though, 2024 is just 3 years away. And still talking about the moon, an incredible new radar instrument has provided us with a very detailed image of the Apollo 15 landing site, the Hadley Rill region. The Green Bank Telescope in West Virginia, the largest fully steerable radio telescope in the world, was in fact equipped with a new transmitter, which allows it to transmit a powerful radar signal into space. Last November, a test was conducted by launching a radar signal towards the famous Hadley Rill. The return signal was then collected by the Very Long Baseline Array that has then converted into an image capable of showing details up to 5 meters in size. Not bad for a photo taken from 400,000 kilometers away. But that's not all. Experts are working on an even more powerful transmitter, a high-powered radar system, 500 kilowatts, that will allow us to capture even smaller details, reaching as far as the orbits of Uranus and Neptune. We will also be able to see any objects just outside our solar system, as well as asteroids and space debris too faint to be detected with our optical telescopes. In short, those who are still crying over the Arecibo radio telescope, known to be at the forefront of radar detection, from now on will have good reason to console themselves. But in the field of radio astronomy, there is even bigger news. One of the grand scientific projects of the 21st century is a go. The first council meeting of the Square Kilometer Array Observatory has action plans that will lead to the biggest telescope on Earth being assembled over the coming decade. Member states approved a 1,000-page document covering everything from the power to open a bank account to engaging with industrial contractors. The SKA telescope will comprise a vast information of radio receivers. These will be positioned across South Africa and Australia. The array's resolution and sensitivity, allied to prodigious computing support, will enable astronomers to address some of the most fundamental questions in astrophysics today. How did the first stars come to shine in the universe? What exactly is dark energy, the mysterious form of energy that appears to be driving the cosmos apart at an accelerating rate? And even the most basic question of all, are we alone? The SKA's unprecedented sensitivity would pick up any extraterrestrial transmissions. A key next step, of course, is to build the telescope. The expectation is that invitations to tender will go out to industry from July, with groundbreaking ceremonies expected towards the end of the year. The observatory is centered on remote, uninhabited locations in the Karoo in South Africa's Northern Cape and the Murchison in Western Australia. The telescope will incorporate a mix of parabolic antennas or dishes, as well as dipole antennas, which look a little like traditional TV aerials. The aim is to construct an effective collecting area measuring hundreds of thousands of square meters. The system will operate across a frequency range from roughly 50 MHz to ultimately 25 GHz. In wavelength terms, this is in the centimeters to meters range. With the engineered sensitivity, this should enable the telescope to detect very faint radio signals coming from cosmic sources billions of light years from Earth, including those signals emitted in the first few hundred million years after the Big Bang, when the first galaxies and stars started forming. Construction and operation of the SKA over this decade is likely to consume about $2.4 billion, and that the construction will take from 7 to 8 years. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Thinking about the extraordinary image of the moon obtained by the Green Bank Observatory, a radar of that power would have been useful to the dinosaurs of the Cretaceous period, who could have noticed what was falling on them at least a little in advance. Okay, we said this nonsense to make you aware of the fact that the diatribes about the true nature of the cosmic projectile responsible for the extinction of our big reptile friends continue. The story of the KT event, so-called because it happened at the border between the Cretaceous and Tertiary eras, in fact often returns to the fore with new studies and theories. Remember, we already talked about it in the video, How Dinosaurs Really Got Extinct. 66 million years ago, an object with a diameter between 10 and 14 kilometers impacted the Earth. It was neither the first nor the last such event, but it became the most famous because its fall coincided with the disappearance of the dinosaurs. The impact occurred in Chicxulub, Mexico, and left a crater about 180 kilometers in diameter, now submerged off the Mexican coast. It was thought that the only cosmic object capable of opening on the Earth's surface such a scar would only be an asteroid. The latest news is that it would not have been an asteroid, but a comet to cause the extinction of the dinosaurs. This would indicate new simulations conducted by two Harvard astronomers, whose results are published in the journal Scientific Reports. The authors of the study argue that a comet heading towards the inner solar system may have been deflected towards the Sun by the gravitational field of Jupiter, passing so close to be broken up by the tidal forces of our star. Some fragments would have crossed Earth's orbit, and one of them would have then hit the Earth. All this on the basis that recent studies have shown that the object responsible for the impact had to be a carbonaceous chondrite, relatively rare among asteroids, and instead more common among comets. Well, if you want our opinion, it seems to us early to draw definitive conclusions. Those presented are only clues and not certain evidence, and still many investigations are necessary before we can establish the true nature of the impactor or impactors that have caused the most famous mass extinction in history. With asteroids, we are not finished yet. You surely know that Jupiter's gravitational field, together with the Sun's gravitational field, controls a system of asteroids called Trojans, located at two equilibrium points of the Sun-Jupiter gravitational system called Lagrange points. In the three-body problem, the Lagrange points, technically called oscillation points, are those points in space where two bodies endowed with great mass, such as the Sun and Jupiter, allow a third body endowed with much less mass to maintain a stable position relative to them. In the specific case of Jupiter, we can say that these two regions of equilibrium are located along the orbit of the planet, positioned 60 degrees ahead and 60 degrees behind the planet. regions that, thanks to this particularity, host thousands of asteroids. Generally, all these asteroids are called Trojans, but those located in the Lagrangian point before the planet are called Greeks. Well, until recently, astronomers thought that the two groups of Greek and Trojan asteroids had very similar properties, but the latest observations have revealed that the Greeks seem to be slightly more numerous and with an average more elongated and angular shape. And someone wanted to explain this with the fact that the Greek asteroids, being in greater number, have had more opportunities to collide with each other, and consequently appear to have much more eccentric and strange shapes. Will it be true? At the moment, we do not know, but maybe an answer will come from the Lucy mission starting in October of this year. The mission is named after the fossil hominid, called Lucy by its discoverers, whose skeleton has provided a unique insight into the evolution of humanity. Likewise, the Lucy mission will revolutionize our understanding of planetary origins and the formation of the solar system. Or at least, that is what is hoped. Lucy will complete a 12-year journey to 8 different asteroids, one main belt asteroid and 7 Trojans spread between Greeks and Trojans proper. That's right, Lucy's complex journey will take her to visit both sets of Trojans, 5 astronomical units apart, and give us, for the first time, a global view of the ancient asteroidal population. No other space mission in history has been launched to so many different destinations in independent orbits around our Sun. Lucy will show us, for the first time, the diversity of primordial bodies that build planets. Lucy's discoveries will open up new insights into the origins of our Earth and ourselves. We'll be talking about Lucy for a long time to come. That's it for this week. However, stay tuned to the Insane Curiosity channel to not miss anything that happens within the universe. Between news and insights, we will never leave you uninformed.